some reason, the yarn must be a little thicker on me.
And there's disappointment.
This one's just a tad short.
Let's not wait for anything.
Oh, that's okay. Sorry.
In Psalm 90, if you study that out, it is on the time that they're in the wilderness. He's talking about age, he's talking about the futility, that really after 70, the reason the Lord begins to take them home is because they just get so overwhelmed. There's just so much evil, there's just so much, they just kind of lose the zeal and zest for things. The bodies don't work, you know, it's a difficult time. And so he's talking about Moses' prayer is, okay, well, if that's the case, if God says it is, well, then we need mercy. And so he begins to talk about mercy, and he begins to talk about that's his prayer that he gets. So, which is true. Yes, it gets hard.
Where are you putting your stuff?
Right there.
Oh.
Oh, well, I can put it up front with my stuff.
Well, I just want to make sure you don't forget it.
Yeah, there's only maybe a 80% chance that I would forget it. So the percent used to be 90. So I'm getting better.
Yeah.
How you doing?
Good. Present.
Oh, my goodness. And what is this? Sugini?
It's for your wife.
Okay. Is this sugini?
Yes.
Okay. I got a lot of zucchini.
Oh!
But I don't have zucchini in this fish. This is a lot of zucchini.
That's a big zucchini.
Yeah.
That's because she wants to make
a zucchini
more
bread. I hope.
Brownie.
Oh, brownie. These are brownies?
Yeah.
What kind of brownies, though? Like green brownies or regular brownies?
Regular brownies.
Great stuff.
With chocolate chips and
oh my yummy.
Goodness. Oh, my goodness.
And some green stuff.
Hey, so it's healthy because it's got green stuff in it.
No, I'm hoping it doesn't have any green stuff in it.
I like your shirt.
Oh.
We were just talking. I was talking to my 7-year-old granddaughter yesterday about me. Ooh, and I said, who's your favorite character? Oh, Tigger.
Tigger, the other one.
So there I said, no, I like Roo. Okay.
No, it is that.
Why is
he
here? No, you only need to take one then. No, well, if you want to take one,
yes,
that's fine. Okay.
Is it a two-pager? Or
yes,
a
two-pager.
Okay.
Hi.
Hello.
How you doing?
I'm good.
How's that bad?
So here's a two-pager.
Well, that's a three-pager.
How far down is it?
Three sizes. Yes.
Zero?
You're right.
No.
Oh. No, there's always a change. There's always one more day. There's always, can so, you?
Yeah. And it's great, so it's busy. Busy season. So, yeah.
Oh, is this the busy season?
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, I guess. So, well, anyway, I
well, it looks right now that we're outnumbered there. 1, 2, 3, 4 women,
just
2 guys.
Oh, I thought you meant by
We're outnumbered.
Well, the kids, I think,
were
definitely outnumbered.
Yeah.
Well, there's about
there's
6 or
8
kids or something. So, yeah, there was a couple of guests supposed to come tonight, too. I think we might have 8 or 9 kids.
They were all running in the
heat.
So, do you miss her?
I think mine. Only to let their energy.
Their energy and our wisdom, right?
Yeah, that would be great.
That makes a difference.
Yeah.
Like today, our initial mom took it to my rivers. I'm going to take pull his hair away. Right? He's got a long out. Of course, right under the good eye, he's got a cut. So I'm taking it to the back later. That's all around. Kind of, you know, trade on and stuff like that. So I know all those little things.
Yes.
Yeah.
Having a dog is like having kids.
It is.
A child.
It is. And they're trying to. They're saying that they need to bring
How do you get blood young?
I don't know.
Oh, just in the activist?
Yeah, he just woke up. I'm actually going to talk to Dr. But he's got a doctor's appointment on Friday, so it's like all building up to it. So I dealt with that for like an hour, and then he wanted to stay awake and watch TV. That was not happening. And then he woke up, and then he had a play date this afternoon, and then I sort of I know. I don't want to just go crash on the ice.
Is Rick coming tonight?
Yeah.
He's been a blessing. Oh my goodness, that's great to have him in here.
Hello.
Is he enjoying it?
He loves the 8:30s.
Oh, yeah, I know. I just think we're going to keep this.
Hello.
All right, well, we're going to start.
Hello, Robin.
All right, good morning, good afternoon, good evening.
I'm going
to say all three of those, glad that you're here tonight. Thank you for coming. Thank you if you're on live stream for being part of the service tonight. We are studying the book of Ephesians, and we're in actually chapter number 5. Jim, on the back table there are two sheets, need one of each.
Okay, thanks.
And so glad that you were able to make it tonight. We have a good amount of kids in the back as well, which is good too for us to minister to them. Let's open up with a word of prayer as we prepare our hearts and minds for the service tonight. Father, thank you for Christ. Thank you for the joy we have in being able to know you, but not only know you, but serve you and live for you. So thank you for those that are able to attend by live stream. We pray that we would learn as much as we can about you and who you are. Bless those that are here tonight, that they would be encouraged, and those that are on live stream too, that they would be challenged in their walk with you. Help us not to help us to try to stay engaged in the teaching of your word. Thank you that we can. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. All right, well, tonight is going to be Ephesians chapter number 5. So I want to take your Bibles there. Ephesians chapter number 5. Remember that in the book of Ephesians, the society is just like the society we have today. There is gross sin. There is people that are not maybe involved in that sin, but they're living a life that would not certainly be godly at all. They're unbelievers. But now there's a church that is there. Paul spent, I don't know if it was the most amount of time or the second most amount of time in one area, teaching and preparing the people after they got saved to grow in their Christ-likeness. There's no greater, what we should do as a church, and that is to be teaching one another, seeing ourselves grow in our Christ-likeness. So in Ephesians chapter number 5, we're going to look at verse number 1 and verse number 2. So I'll read verse number 1, and you read verse number 2. The Bible says, Ephesians chapter 5, verse number 1, "Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children,
and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us, and hath been given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor."
So as we begin to look at this, our title is "Be Ye Followers of God." Be Ye Followers of God. As we begin to look at chapter number 5 of the book of Ephesians, we are called to be like God. We are called to love all as He loves. How can we? As sinful, human, frail, failing people, ever be like Him or love like Him? Aren't you glad that He loves you unconditionally? Aren't you glad that He loves you with a perfect love and a just love? But we're called to be followers of God, to mimic Him. The text says that we need to follow His example. His example. We find that in our text that we just read. In fact, in verse number 1, "Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children." We're children of the Lord, of God. We've been adopted into the family. We're sons and daughters. Paul writes, be followers of God. So it's okay to be a baby Christian, but it's never okay to be a Christian baby. So it's okay for us to be growing in our Christ-likeness. At times, I feel like I'm growing and I'm starting to understand the scriptures better. And then all of a sudden, I'll open up to a passage and I'll feel right back as a baby Christian, trying to get my arms and understand the depth and how deep God's word is. It's just, you never get to the point where you say, hey, I've arrived. I got it. I understand it. I really don't need church. I don't need to be studying God's word anymore. That never happens. Well, our first point here to take a look at, there is a person to imitate. There is a person to imitate. We have learned that when we see the word therefore, it causes our attention to look back to the last verses of the previous chapter. So whenever you see wherefore or therefore in the scriptures, if you're going to be a Bible studier, it means that you need to go back and read what happened in chapter number 4 so you can understand why we have a chapter number 5. And it calls our attention to look back to the last verses of the previous chapter. We see that the saints of God have been saved by grace of God, and because they have been saved, they are to be different in the way they walk. I hope your walk is different. I can remember at times being at a restaurant or being in somewhere. I can remember back. I wish I could remember the day and how old I was. I remember going into a hospital and I was eating in their cafeteria, and I remember that when I got up there, the lady who served me, I was watching her as she was serving others. And when I got up there, I just said to her right away, I said, are you a Christian? And she said, I sure am. And I said, I could tell. I could tell just the way that she was interacting with the people, even though she was not quoting verses. I could tell that there was something different about her. Your manner of life ought to be different. The way you talk and the way you think. I hope you think differently. I hope the way you used to think bothers you. The old man, the flesh, the old man, the sin, with all its evil desires and appetites, needs to be put off. We need to literally allow the Holy Spirit to allow us to put off the old man. In other words, take the grave clothes off. We find that in Ephesians 4:22. And the new man, created in righteousness, is to be put on. We need to put on Christ. I think I mentioned this once here before, and that is when I first got saved, I certainly didn't know anything. I just knew I was saved. And I remember every morning I was in the military, and when I got up and began to put on my clothes, then there was a dungaree set that I had to put on for my work. And so I remember that when these young men that were discipling me, were all the same age, about 19 or 20, they were discipling me. They were telling me about putting on Christ and putting off the old works. And I remember I'd get up and I put them on through my legs first, and I had to put them on here. And I remember as I put it on, I tried to remember, this is just like putting on Christ. I'm doing it on purpose. I'm putting him on purpose. I hope every day that you consciously put on Christ before you leave your house. Since we have been made a new creature in Jesus, we can live a new creature in our daily lives, the new creation. The Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 2, verse 6, he that saith, abide in him, ought him himself also to walk even as he walked. So now that we're born again, we ought to walk after Christ. We ought to walk after the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul's challenging each believer in Ephesus and in our generation to bring our tongue, our anger, our work, our ethic, our work ethic, rather, our bitterness, our revenge, and all sin submitted all to God. God, take this away. Give me victory over these areas of my life, submitting it to him, and allow him to display us as forgiving, kind, compassionate towards one another. You know, I see that in you here. Many of you, I'm sure, before you were saved, were not this. And now that you've been saved, I see a kindness. I see a compassion for one another, a long-suffering, and that's where we ought to be. But Ephesians 5:1 poses the greatest challenge of all. So let's examine this challenge, because that's what we're looking at tonight. A closer look lets us see that it is a command and not an option. So what we find here, the command is, be ye followers. followers of God. It's not an option. It's not like, hey, if you want to. God is saying, be ye, or Paul is saying, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, be ye followers of God. The word for follower means an imitator. Have you ever seen somebody imitate somebody else? Maybe those of you that have had children, you have seen that your children imitate you. Maybe when they were really little, they did what you did. I remember I would have tools, and so I remember my kids would pick up tools. They would follow me around. They would imitate me and some of the actions or some of the work that I was doing. And that was a form of flattery, that somebody would imitate you. Well, we don't want them to imitate us. We want them to imitate our Father. The command here is for people of God to imitate God. Now, we're not to be equal with God. We're not to think the way Lucifer did, that I'll be like God. We are to actually imitate God and his characteristics and his attributes so that other people would see that in us. That is why it's important to know God. If we are to follow his characteristics, we must know them. We must know his attributes. The thought from the human side is that children are like their parents. That is amazing. It doesn't take long to be around your children, whether they're grown up or not, and see you in them. See you in them. This can be encouragement, or it can be quite embarrassing. So it can be both. Can you think of times your children mimic you? We need to imitate our Father. That is our Heavenly Father. Let me ask you, are you? Are you consciously? Because it is a command to be followers of God, to imitate him. Well, number 8 would be walk in love. The word walk is found 7 times in the book of Ephesians. The understanding of this word is key to the believer. The word walk in our text means to follow, to adhere to, a person or an activity. Let me see here. I'm on page number 2 because mine are not back to back. We are unable to imitate God through our own power, though. Just as we can't be holy on our own, however, as redeemed children of God, we have been empowered to live like, act like, talk like, love like, share like our Heavenly Father. In no way are we on par with him. But we ought to be able to show these type of attributes and actions in our life that people say, wow, you're much different. And when they find out who we're much different like, they can see their Heavenly Father, their Creator as well. So he's empowered us and he's enabled us to live holy lives for his glory. I'm glad he has. We can grow. We can change. We can be in the image of the Lord Jesus Christ, but we can also follow or imitate our Heavenly Father. Paul points out in the previous verse the importance of walking in love. This was foreign to the people of Ephesus. I remember when I got saved, and after I had been walking with the Lord for a while, I was challenged by a person that told me that I seemed to be very formed and not very compassionate. And I said, wow, they really kind of hit that because I didn't grow up a compassionate person. I didn't grow up loving on people. And that was a challenge to me because we ought to be that way. We ought to be loving people. They grew up in a society much like ours today. Get what you can at any cost. And we see that today, the way that some people or the way we act towards one another. Paul was exhorting the church to love one another and walk in love that was a demonstration to you by God. It was demonstrated to you by God. Be gracious on others and hard on yourself instead of hard on others and gracious on yourself. It's so easy to find what's wrong with everybody else, but we ought to be loving and gracious. The Bible tells us, as we studied last week, let all bitterness, wrath, and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. That's why.
Amen.
So Paul gives us several reasons why we as believers should walk in love. One, You are God's child. You are God's child. You have been changed because of the new birth, and you now possess a divine nature. Selena, on the back right here, on this little ledge, is in the front here, is two pieces of paper. Right there, front and back. 2 Peter 1:4 tells us, whereby are given unto you exceedingly great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. So we have a divine nature. God has given it to us. And we are able to overcome and escape the corruption that's in the world today and follow God in love. The old nature is selfish, and you were blind to your sinful nature, but now you're alive in God, and by His grace and the divine nature, you can submit to God. Overcome the old nature and live in a way that builds bridges and makes peace. One thing that ought to happen with born-again believers is relationships ought to be restored. You ought to, as you grow in your Christ-likeness and begin to get confident in what God is doing in your life, you ought to try to bridge relationships that were broken before you got saved. And if there's relationships today that are broken, you ought to reach out. You may never be best friends with them again, but you ought to make sure that you're right with one another. I heard a very challenging message at MBT on this exact subject, and I had to leave the message and call two people. And just go back and bridge some things and get some things right. Get some things right. We ought to be making sure that we are able to bridge those relationships back, because why? God is love. And God forgave you. God restored you. God has been gracious to you. Now, when you go back and try to mend those relationships, they don't always mend to where they were before, but you can have a cordial relationship. And sometimes they do come back to full restoration. But we're to do that. If you are in a restaurant and a lady or a man comes up and takes your drink order, and so you order an iced tea or a lemonade, and that waitress writes it down, and she says, okay, iced tea and lemonade. When she begins to walk away, you stand up and say, oh, everybody in the restaurant, let's give this woman an applause. She took my drink order. Oh, bravo. Bravo. We expect her to do that. We expect him to do that. May I say, mending relationships is expected. It's not for you to stand up and get an applause because you called somebody and mended. God expects you to mend relationships that are broken and not to allow them to get so far apart that there can be no relationship. So keep a short account. If something takes place, then go get it right away with somebody. But it's expected because you're God's child. You're a beloved child. And we're to bridge, that builds bridges and makes peace. Christians don't have to be at war. Now we might not agree, we might not be happy with the situation that's going on, but we ought to be bridge makers and peacemakers. Are you a peacemaker? Sometimes we can say we're a peacemaker, but really the way that we respond, we're really not. It's passive aggressive. We act like we care, but really we say bad things about people anyways. We ought not to be doing that. So you are God's child. Second, you are his beloved child. Not only are you God's child, but you're his beloved child. The word beloved here, or the word dear in our text means beloved, or you're a dear child. You're a dear child of the most, you're the most heavenly creature, the Father, the deity. Because we are born again, we are his sons and daughters. Let's look how God spoke to his beloved son, his dear son, Jesus Christ, in Matthew 3:17, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved son, in whom I am what?
Well pleased.
Well pleased. Can I tell you that's what God's saying about you? He's saying that about you? This is my beloved daughter. This is my beloved son, in whom I'm well pleased. For whose sake? For Christ's sake. And you are a beloved and a dear. dear child. Don't let that be taken away from you. He speaks the same way of us. We are to be imitators or followers of him in our manner, meaning, and in our walk. In John 17:23, God says this, I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them, and thou hast loved me. God loves us. We are his children. You love your children. Doesn't mean that you don't get upset at them sometimes, especially when they're in those critical ages, but you love them. When we were saved, we were born into a perfect family. We were born into a perfect family. A perfect example to follow because our relationship, we ought to display the same love in our relationship as well as we live. Selena, would you mind giving him 2 sheets of paper so he doesn't have to get up with Emma in his hands? We're on point number 3, which is on the second page. Point number 3, and that is Christ shows us a perfect example. So not only are we God's children, not only are we his dear children, not only does he love us, but also God shows us a perfect example. Christ is always the best example to look at. I am not your best example because I am human just like you are. You hang out with me long enough, I see Janet here shaking her head. Mm-hmm. You hang out with me long enough, you'll see my flaws as well. But there are no flaws in Jesus Christ. He is perfect, and he is the paragon of holiness, and we can look at him. The Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2, and walk in love, as Christ also has loved us, and has given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for sweet-smelling savor, smell in the nostrils. My daughter was over today, Jackie, and two of the grandchildren, and when she ran out to the stores, we watched the kids for a little bit. When she came in, she was smelling dinner, and she said, whoa, she says, that smells good. That smells good. There's something about that fresh cooked food in the oven and it permeating out through the building or through the house. And she smelled that in the same way because of Christ. The sweetness of our life can be that way in God's nostrils as well. Paul said, Christ laid down his life as an offering, a presentation. For sin is a demonstration of Christ's love for the Father and for us. That is what we are to mimic or trace. Our life is a presentation. God, here's my life. It's not mine. It's like taking a piece of paper and signing your name on the bottom and letting God write in what he wants of you. Is your life a presentation unto the Father? That's what Jesus was. Jesus was the perfect offering. He said, God, I am offering my life, I'm presenting my life to be that sacrifice that will be pleasing to you and, of course, redeem sinful man. The first 5 chapters of Leviticus, now how many of you get excited when you get to the book of Leviticus? It's just like we talked about Chronicles. You get all pumped up about it. But can I tell you, and I challenge you this, is the book of Leviticus, if you can master it or get to know it, it will open up the New Testament for you in the sacrificial lamb, Christ, as well as helping you to understand the book of Hebrews. I wrote in here a couple books that I highly recommend that you would read along with Leviticus, and I think it really helped you understand a little bit more about the great sacrifice that took place. The first 5 chapters, once again, of Leviticus describes 5 offerings commanded by God of Israel. The first 3 were the burnt offering, the meat offering, and the peace offering. And the last 2 were the sin offering. The sin offering. So there's 5 offerings that are talked about there in Leviticus. Let's just look at a few of them because they relate to what we're learning today. Because Christ was our perfect example. We see that because he was depicted So the burnt offering, Leviticus chapter 1, verse 1 and verse 9, says depicted Christ as total devotion to God in giving his very life to obey and please his Father. That's the same for us. We ought to be the same way. We ought to be presenting our bodies, presenting our life, presenting while we're here on earth a devotion of giving everything just like Christ did to please his Father. Everything that Jesus Christ did pleased his Heavenly Father. He never disappointed him. His whole life, his whole body, his whole mindset was given over to the Father. The total body was sacrificed, a representation of giving of all. Your body needs to be mortified, given over to God. Your hands, your feet, your eyes, your legs, your mind, your eye gate, your ear gate, all that you take in. When you're watching something and they use the Lord's name in vain, you ought to turn it off. If you're doing something and you see it's not proper, it's not right, the Holy Spirit smote your heart, and get away from it. That's what Christ did. Christ gave his whole life over to the Lord. And in 3 years, God accomplished everything in Christ's open ministry on his way to the cross. The second is the meat offering. That's found in Leviticus chapter 2. If you'll notice that all these sacrifices have their own chapter. So as you look, chapter 1 is the burnt offering. Chapter number 2 is the meat offering. The peace offering, then 4 and 5 are the sin offering. So the peace offering, the meat offering in Leviticus chapter 2, verses 1, 2, and 9, depict Christ's perfection, that he was willing to obey the Father's will. How about you? There are a lot of things that you know are the Father's will, but yet we choose not to follow them. Like God would show us in his scriptures that this is my will. Let me give you the ridiculous to show you the obvious, because we can all be in agreement with this, and that is we would all believe that stealing is wrong. Alright? So we know that is wrong. Then that is the Father's will. So why would we steal? Well, let's get where it's a little bit tougher. The Bible says it is the perfect will of God for you to give him thanksgiving in everything. Oh my. In everything. In everything. That's the perfect will of God. We know that. But it's difficult, isn't it? The Bible says that we are to forgive one another no matter what the situation is. We're to forgive one another. That is the will of God. So it's easy to understand what this is saying, but it's hard to obey it. I just let the Holy Spirit maybe bring some things to your mind that you know is the will of God. If you take your Bibles, and we won't turn many places, but if you take your Bibles, if you're at home as well, and turn to the book of Romans, chapter number 12, and the Bible says, in verse number 2, the Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse number 2, and be ye not conformed. Think of a cookie cutter. Now it makes the same cookies. You just spread the dough out and a little cookie cutter, you put it in, and all the cookies look exactly the same. Don't be conformed to this world. Don't allow it to press you into its mold. Don't be like this world. So be not conformed to this world, but be ye what?
Transformed,
changed by the renewing of your mind, that you may be able to prove. That's discern. That word means to discern. To discern what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. In other words, God says that if you give your life over to him, he will give you the discernment to know what is the perfect will of God, and by that you should obey it. But if you don't spend any time in the scriptures, you won't know what the will of God is. So you need to be in the will of God in the Bible to know his will. So we got the burnt offering in Leviticus, we've got the meat offering in Leviticus, and now in chapter number 3, we have the peace offering. In Leviticus chapter 3, verses number 1 and number 5. Actually, those verses in between do talk about it, but these are the main verses that would help you to see it a little clearer. Depicts in making peace between God and man. When God and man was in the garden, Adam, there was peace. But when man rebelled, the peace was broken. Through Christ, we have peace. We've been reconciled back with the Savior, back with our God. So if it takes peace, depicts him making peace between God and man after offered to God upon the other two offerings, a part was given back to the priest as a sign of peace. God's priest and man shared the same meal. In the same way, God shares with us. We have been made peace through Christ. And through that, God gives us peace that passeth all understanding. And we walk together, sharing that fellowship as Adam and God did in the garden. We can have that. He shares the same meal with us. Christ was that man. Would be that man. All those offerings obviously spoke of what was pleasing to God. Of each, the scriptures say it provided a soothing aroma to the Lord. Now, there's a cologne that I have. I don't know what kind of cologne you guys wear, but I'm an Old Spice guy. I don't know, maybe some.
Like my dad.
The old commercials where the guy would throw to the sailor and he kind of bundled a little bit, you know, trying to catch it, but I've just always been an Old Spice guy. Well, my wife does not like the smell of that. So that presents a problem. So I have bottles of Old Spice that I use when I'm traveling. But at home, I don't put it in. Why? Because as soon as I put it on, she's rolling the wheels out and saying, oh my goodness. That's it, you're watching this. It's all my, you know? This is a terrible smell. But can I tell you, these offerings that are discussed here are just the opposite. They are a wonderful aroma in the nostrils of the Lord. A wonderful. And you can look these up later. In fact, I wrote the verses down for you later for you to look at. I have them all down here. Leviticus 1:9, 1:13, 1. Let's just read one of them. Just drop down your eyes down to the bottom of that page. And Leviticus 1:9. But his inwards and his legs shall be washed in water, that's the sacrifice. And the priest shall burn all on the altar to be a burnt sacrifice, an offering made by fire, a what?
Sweet savory
unto the Lord. And it goes on and on and on how important that this was to the Lord, because it showed obedience. The book of Leviticus is a powerful book. If you can go through it slowly, probably with a guide, a good commentary, you will find things in there that really show the importance of the sacrifice to Christ today and also to us. So we see through the life of Christ that his walk was a perfect example of following his Father's will. Your life ought to be that goal. You know what the Lord's will is for you, and we are to follow that. The sons of Eli, he was a heavyset man in the Old Testament that had two sons. Eli was the priest at the time that Samuel was a child. Do you remember when Hannah dropped off her son? Remember she prayed, Hannah did, in Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 1, she prayed for a child, and Eli thought she was drunk, and she said, no. And so she had the child, and she dedicated him. While he was the priest at that time, the sons of old Eli did not imitate their father. They were very evil, and they were doing wicked things in the temple. They were not good imitators of Eli, who was a follower of God. And the sons of Samuel did not imitate their father. Absalom did not imitate his father David. But the Lord Jesus Christ imitated his father. He was an exact duplicate. Well, who are you going to follow? Satan is a fallen foe, but he was our father in the sense of before we were saved. And we ought to not manifest those fleshly tendencies. He's a liar. He's an adulteress. He's a murderer. And he is the father of every one of those sins. And we ought to not mimic him because he is dead. And we are alive in Christ. Jesus said, to see me is to see the Father. So what an example we have if we follow Christ, then we see the Father in the sense of a loving, giving, gracious, just, fair Father that we can mimic or follow. If we were like gods, if one were like God, what would they be like? Well, if we were to follow God and we were to manifest the type of attitudes and actions that God had, this would describe us. You'd be kind. You'd be kind. You'd be tender-hearted. Think about those adjectives that describe these attributes. You'd be tender-hearted. You'd be tender towards people. Even when they were mean to you, you'd just be tender towards that. You'd be tender-hearted. You'd be forgiving. You'd be forgiving. Just like the waitress example that we gave earlier, we don't applaud her when she brings our drinks. We expect it. God expects you to be forgiving one another. Do you mimic God? Great form of flattery. When our kids mimic us, we like that. I remember when Michael Jordan was very popular here in Chicago in the 90s, when they were winning all the championships. Michael Jordan had a tendency, and not a tendency, he had whenever he played, which every parent would say, don't do this, or coach would, he stuck his tongue out. Well, we had a whole generation of basketball players with stitches in their tongues. Because they were playing because they wanted to be like Mike. All the commercials for Gatorade was be like Mike. I want to be like Mike. And they wanted to imitate Michael Jordan. And I understand what they were trying to do. They were trying to sell Gatorade. And so on. We don't want to mimic Michael Jordan. We don't want to mimic me. We don't want to mimic you. We want to mimic our Father. Boy, I'll tell you what. What a loving Father. That's why you love God. He just loves you unconditionally. He's so kind and so fair. The sacrifice of God was a blood sacrifice. Christ took away the wrath of God. Two things happened on the cross. Not only did he die for our sins, but he also was our propitiation. He appeased God's wrath towards sin. And so now we have peace with God. He satisfied it. Only Christ could be that blood sacrifice. Not only did he bear our sins, but he shed his blood. We can get better at tracing the picture, but we'll always have to follow the example. I remember when we were little, we would put a piece of paper over something, and we would draw around it as though we drew it. Though, of course, we did not. But you ladies that we have here that knit, crochet, and sew, and maybe some men, I don't know, I've never been into that, but you use a pattern. I remember my mom used to sew. I remember her taking those patterns out, and she would pin them, I guess. I guess she pinned them on the house. She got them all the material. Straight. She would lay the material out, and I see her on her hands and knees. In the living room, and she'd be laying those patterns out, and then she would cut them out, and then she would sew them. And she had a sewing machine before she had an electric one, where you push that little bar, and it would go up and down, the needle would go. And she would sew clothes for the girls, for them, for certain things that they needed to have those things for. Christ is our pattern. He is worthy to follow. Trace him. Know him. How many of you are familiar with Fanny Crosby, the songwriter? Helen Keller, if you, Annie Sullivan was her teacher, and when she began to say waters like Wawa, and then she began to be able to get letters on her hand, and she was able to communicate, no one spending time with her, and Annie Sullivan began to tell her about a God, and she was able to write back, you can read this, it's worthy to read. She said, I knew there was somebody, I just didn't know who he was. But we do know who he is. And we're not like Frank Crosby where we can't see. We're not like Helen Keller. We can trace him on the dial right here. We can look at his attributes and trace them right through the scripture so we can be like him. Now, a little change in subject as we come and draw to an end. Leviticus can appear to be a difficult book. However, it is a book when you get your arms around its teaching, it will open up the book of Hebrews, the crucifixion of Christ, and the importance of living a dedicated life. I recommend these two books to help you through your study. There's a book by Andrew Bonner. It's a book on Leviticus, and it's easy to read. I call it the Dick and Jane book. It's got small words, and I'm right with it. And then there's another book I have that was written by George Bush, not the George Bush that was the president, the two presidents. George Bush on Leviticus. Now, that book is highly scholarly. When I read that book, I have to spend time looking up the words that he's telling me to help me understand the words that I can't understand. But it is deeper, and it is a little bit more if you want to go a little bit deeper in that book as well. Enjoy your study, and it'll open up an endless understanding of God's truth. And so below are the verses that we looked at tonight in the book of Leviticus. So here's the challenge as we come to a close tonight, is that we're to be followers. We're to be followers of God. And our example is a perfect example, and that is Jesus Christ. So, be followers is a command. It is the will of God for us to be followers of Him. How do we do that? As sinful, redeemed people, we look to the example of Christ, and we commit it through His life as well by looking at how He pleased the Father. And we see that in Leviticus in some of the offerings, but we also find it in other places as well. I pray that you will grow in your Christ-likeness because Paul says chapter 4, 5, and 6 of the book of Ephesians is the practical. Not the doctrinal, the practical. And so I hope that you'll be practical in your walk as well. Sunday will be church. I hope you can make it. And then also don't forget to be on our prayer call on Saturday at 7 o'clock. It's a time for us to gather together, whether there's one person or 5,000. We haven't had 5,000 online yet. But whether we have that or 20 people online, it doesn't matter. It's a time that we can intercede. So what we're going to do now is we're going to turn off the live streaming, even though it's 7:20, because we're going to gather together in prayer right here. We're going to pray, and I exhort you in your homes to take these next 10 minutes or how much time you want to take and go ahead and pray as well. So thank you for being part of our live stream today. Please, I'm not ever shaming you, but I can't exhort you enough to put on your heart and mind, and I send it out in an email, the reason why we gather together. It is a priority for us to gather together. I hope you'll take that seriously.